Welcome, welcome to the Microbiome Report. I am your host, Andrea Ween, and I just have a few housekeeping items before we dive into today's episode. We have redesigned the Biome site, so our show notes have found a new home, which can be a little bit confusing if you've listened to past episodes and are trying to find the show notes. So if you're looking for this episode or any past episode notes, you can go to biomehealth.com/pages/podcast, and you'll find them all there. I also wanted to share some goodness with everyone that Biome is offering 10% off of any product on their site with the code BIOHM10. It's BIOHM10. So if you've been eyeing something on their site, go check it out. And I also just want to make an ask that if you've been listening to the show and haven't left us a review yet, I would be so thrilled if you could do that today. The reviews and ratings really make such a huge difference in the visibility of each episode and in our ability to continue to do what we do. So thank you so much in advance for helping us out. Now let's get into this episode. I won't say too much about it other than this is a straight from the gut episode where I riff with Afif Ghanoom, the CEO of Biome, about the latest research and the state of the industry. This is really a far-reaching episode. We get into everything from major funding for the space to babies and Mars. Enjoy the show. Afif, how's it going?
Good. How are you?
I'm good. It's like every time we do these, another month has passed and I just can't even really believe it.
I know. And I was just saying earlier, I can't believe it's 8 months into COVID, which is just blowing my mind.
I know. Everyone was like, oh, by the fall, you know, things will be back to normal. And now it's like, well, who even knows?
Well, I was saying to my wife, I remember saying like in like May, do you think people would be like up for coming over for a party in August? And like, oh my God, it's just, it's really insane.
I know. Ugh. Anyway, moving on. We're not going to talk about COVID today. So if anyone is feeling fatigued on that, don't worry. We're staying far away from that topic. And in really exciting news, actually, the first thing that we have teed up to talk about is this huge government fund in France. So the French government basically approved a fund that's going to devote over 5 billion euro to microbiome companies before the end of 2022. So in the article, they mentioned that they're going to focus on the microbiota revolution is what they're calling it. So this is going to include drugs, nutritional solutions, diagnostics, biomarkers. And then this fund's also making investments in like digital therapeutics, personalized nutrition and personalized medicine, food tech. And then very interestingly, they are also offering co-investment with corporate players like Novartis and Nestle and Kellogg's and Tyson. So, I mean, 5 billion euro by 2022 is a pretty bold statement.
Yeah, it's huge. So there's two ways to look at this, right? So in one hand, I believe that's the biggest dedicated fund to the microbiome to date. So it's definitely a giant piece of validation. It's interesting that it's a government because usually governments go one of two ways. They either go like over the top and they are willing to invest in stuff that's still a little too early, because they know a lot of companies are having a tough time getting funding. So an easy example of that is like, remember 10 years ago, Obama administration did like a lot of big clean energy investment that ended up being a little bit of a boondoggle, but they were doing it because they're like, you know, if we don't support it, it's going to be hard for the, you know, private industry to support it. So I think that's important. What's interesting is contextually as a fund, 5 billion, and now it is euro. So let's just easy math say that's, you know, 7.5 to 10 billion US. I'm not sure what the conversion
is. But I would say probably around 7 is more okay. Likely. Yeah.
Yeah. So $7 billion, right? So obviously that's a lot of money, but there's two things that are probably important context. One, a single drug to develop is probably a $1 billion proposition. You know what I mean? So like it's a lot of money, but it's still, they will likely need others to help co-invest, especially if it is microbiome therapeutics. But two, there's a lot of investment funds that are like several multiples of that. You know what I mean? So to me, it's super encouraging that, you know, you have a major government putting up that kind of funding, but that's like the tip of the iceberg that we'll need if microbiome therapeutics are really going to, you know, come to fruition. And when we say therapeutics, I always like to explain that that's different than probiotics or, you know, microbiome tests and stuff, that's a therapeutic's really another word for like a true, like FDA approved drug. So, you know, when you think of a therapeutic, think of like, you know, cancer drugs and all these things, it is a huge undertaking, you know?
So from your experience working in the US, obviously, does the French government, like does the EU have different rules around what can be called a therapeutic? What does that space look like? Is it more advanced than where we are now? Like I know with stem cells, for example, you know, we're kind of held back a bit from some of the stuff that's happening in Europe. So where does this play?
Yeah, that's a great question. And as we're talking, I can't remember the name of the European FDA. It looks like it's the EMA. Yeah, that makes sense. Because there's like a CE mark for medical devices in Europe. So EMA is like the FDA equivalent in Europe. So it's interesting. Some things are easier to market both nutritionally and as drugs in Europe versus the US. And then some things are much more difficult. So a lot of companies that I have dealt with, they'll actually go to Europe to get approvals first, then come back to the US because it's actually considered easier a lot of times. So it's still very rigorous. Like, you know, if you get something approved in Europe, it's, you know, sterling standard. But, you know, it's not like there's one sort of, oh, it's easier to get things across the finish line in Europe versus the US. They're both pretty rigorous. It just depends on, you know, the category. Like, for example, probiotics in Europe, I'm 99% sure are much more heavily regulated than they are in the US, you know? So it'll be interesting to see what that actually means. Did you see in the article, did that mean they would also fund things that are in the US or is it just European focused?
It said that they were looking for co-investment internationally, which would lead me to believe that, you know, it would be US based as well.
Well, and the other thing context wise, there's a lot of big players that are actually, if not in France, right around France. So like Danon, which, you know, everybody thinks of as yogurt, but that's a, you know, a company that does all sorts of big microbiotic work based in, I believe, Paris. Then you have like Unilever, who does a lot of stuff based in London. So it's not really surprising that it's coming out of France. France in the microbiome world, they're one of the sort of innovators in the microbiome science space. So pretty interesting.
Yeah, very interesting. And I'm just looking here. The last sentence does say they'll invest in a similar number of companies of the ones that they list. And we'll, of course, link to this in the show notes so people can check it out with a global geography, but with a focus on Europe.
Interesting.
All right, moving on. So there was a study that came out and it's essentially a credit score for your gut health. So they're calling it the Gut Microbiome Health Index. And I'll just give you a quick rundown on what it is, and then we can dig into what we think about it. So it can essentially predict a person's general health by measuring the levels of 50 gut microbial species. So the scientist used over 4,000 stool samples. 2,600 of those came from healthy subjects with no diagnosed illness, and the rest came from non-healthy people. So they had things like colon cancer, diabetes, arthritis, heart disease, obesity. And they essentially homed in on 50 specific microbes that could be used to kind of come up with this score. So they said that 43 of the species were scarce and 7 species were prevalent. And then once they did that, they validated those findings with another set of stool samples and found that they could distinguish between healthy and non-healthy with a little bit over 73% accuracy. So my question was, like, is 50 gut microbial species, is that too narrow? You know, we know we have, I don't know, hundreds, thousands of microbes in there. And a lot of questions came up for me around this. I'd love to hear your thoughts and then I can riff on it again.
Yeah. So there's a couple of thoughts. First, to answer your question, that doesn't surprise me because even when my dad, who for the listeners at home, he's Dr. Ganoum, he's the scientist who named the microbiome, the fungal community in our body. When we developed our microbiome test, we really honed in on 60 core microbiome organisms that are really critical and have been, you know, identified to have a key role in health and wellness. So the fact that they're focusing on 50 actually doesn't surprise me. So why is that? Why, when you're right, there are thousands, if not more, different organisms. It's really two answers. One, a lot of those are transient, which means they'll be introduced into your body usually through like a food, right? So if you eat jalapenos or something, you'll get some organisms that, you know, will be in your gut for a couple of days and then they'll keep moving, right? So those are really not relevant to your health. The other, though, is that it's only, you know, like I said, around probably 60 that we have a ton of data around with implications to health and wellness. So I'm surmising that they're focusing in on those organisms that they feel have the highest level of data around them. And that's what they're using as the indicators. So it's not that the other ones aren't relevant. It's that these are the ones with the most data, right? So, but with that being said, there's two things that I would point out. One, it still means one in four times it's not accurate. Now, that doesn't mean it's bad. It's actually very positive that one, you know, three out of four people, they can sort of guess your health, but it means it's still early days, right? Because when you're talking about accuracy, especially, you know, the implications of this type of finding is that they could take it a step further and say, okay, well, you know, if we can tell you're healthy, we can probably tell you're ill. If we can tell you're ill, we can probably tell you have this condition, right? Like that's the hope with all of these sort of microbiome, you know, diagnostics. We're still a ways away from there because, you know, you're talking about 25% of the time they couldn't. And that doesn't surprise me because there's a lot of factors that influence your microbiome health, like we've talked about many times. But a big one in particular is your genetics and your, obviously, your diet too. Those two things can have a big interplay with your microbiome levels. So it would surprise me that they're able to get, at least at this stage, that level of accuracy. So it's very interesting. And listen, that's a major medical institution, you know, like outside of like Cleveland Clinic, probably the leader. So, you know, it's pretty interesting that they're able to do that because that's been the big missing part, right? So when we're doing our microbiome test, we're able to help you optimize your nutrition, help you really do things to bring your gut into balance. But we don't diagnose whether you're healthy or not because the science has not been there to do that, right? So it is a big deal that they're able to do this and the fact that they validated it. So what I'm actually going to do after we're off, I'm going to call my dad and say, hey, listen, they've done this with, I think you said 4,000 samples overall, is that right?
4,347 to be exact.
Gotcha. So we have several factors bigger than that in our data set. So I'm going to ask my dad, like, can we validate it and look at these organisms, see if we're able to do that? Because that could be pretty interesting.
Yeah. And you brought up the points that I was thinking about too, just in terms of ethnic and geographical populations. You know, they probably didn't look at a large enough sample to be able to say, like, definitively across the board, this is what healthy 50 microbial species looks like. So, you know, maybe it is different in Africa or Europe or some of these other, New Zealand, you know, where they're a little bit off the grid.
But let me pause there. Maybe, yeah. Right? Because the thing that we've talked about before is people have to remember that the vast majority of drugs we use that are prescription were approved with clinical trials, likely under 1,000 people, right? And the data shows that most of the time those people are Caucasian, right? So the reality is sort of the state of science is usually not even using numbers as big as their sample set, which, you know, to me, I always like to mention because I think we're in an age when you hear about data and a lot of times we think of data in terms of not just like scientific data, but like technological data, like our personal data, all these things. Like we think, oh my God, for it to be effective, we need millions of units, right? That's not necessarily true. You know, it's kind of interesting what that delta would be to be able to get it to a level that like FDA, for example, feels like, yep, you know, we feel good that you can use this.
Yeah, for sure. I think, and even in the article, they say that they hope that this analysis could somehow be incorporated into our routine health checkups every year, which is something that we've talked about. You know, this is going to become standard. And I think this is a huge step forward. You know, three out of four, I mean, in the first preliminary stages of development is pretty good.
Actually, you bring up a really good point because I don't know why this is occurring to me, but there's a lot of tests that if you are positive for or negative, then they do much further testing, right? So that initial test is really not that accurate. The one that off the top of my head, I can think about is what, like when we were expecting with our children, we did a test to detect Down syndrome. And I remember it was not definitive, but it was enough that if you were positive for it, they would do further testing. So I could see in the microbiome being used in a similar way, that it's almost used as an initial flag, but maybe it never actually rises to that level of, we're using this as like an end-all be-all, you know, test.
Yeah, for sure. And then I guess the question is, at this stage, do we have that deeper testing, right? Like, is right. this as far as we can go right now? And then,
you but know, it could point you to other things, right? It could sure. point you to like, okay, well, maybe like I just turned 40 this year. So I, you know, when did sort of like the physical you do when you're a 40-year-old man? And it was pretty like underwhelming of how the doctor determined what to test me for. Do you know what I mean? It was like, well, like, you know, we'll do these blood panels and yeah, that's probably about right. You know what I mean? Where as opposed to like, if I did a test like this, maybe like, oh, interesting. This seems to indicate there may be some other issues. You know what? We typically don't test like your liver at this age. We're going to test that. We're going to test, you know, these other issues and do like additional blood panels. So it could be that it, you know, it just unlocks them wanting to do additional testing that you typically wouldn't do, you know?
Definitely. And I think too, what will be interesting, this is something I've talked to your dad about. Does the microbiome become dysbiotic before disease, or does the disease drive the dysbiotic microbiome? And so if we could start to say, it's actually like you have dysbiosis first before any of these other symptoms occur, and we can pinpoint that and say, oh, look, this is maybe even years before, you know, you start to show symptoms of something else. Like, we can say that the microbiome was dysbiotic. Like, that's huge to be able to have prevention and get in front of something.
Yeah. And last thing, and because I know we're trying to cover a bunch of things, the last thing that I'd be interested in knowing is the age range of those samples, because, you know, one of the things you maybe think about is another big impact on your microbiome is the medication you're taking, right? So that would typically start to skew older too, as you start to take more medications as you age. So it'd be interesting to see, to your point, is it like self-fulfilling, or are they, you know, the other thing is, are they hitting people that are unhealthy and that's causing their microbiome to, you know, just what you're saying, to actually go out of whack? So that's where it's super interesting. They've figured this out, but now they're going to have to really delve in, you know?
Yeah. And it definitely sounded like in the article, again, which we'll link to, that those are all questions that they're asking too. So,
awesome.
All right. So this next kind of track of, you know, we had a lot of things come through that were about babies and microbiome of kids and birth specifically. And so they're all loosely tied to each other. So I'll try to loop them in, but we'll start with the first one. So there was a study that came out, it was published in Gastroenterology Journal, and it showed that infants born by C-section were more likely to have a high body mass index score at the ages of 1 and 3. And then when those researchers examined the microbiomes at 3 months, they found an altered ratio of two types of bacteria that were dominant in overweight kids. And then at 12 months, the same thing. And they also found at 12 months, some bacteria that are the main pathways for allergies. So the takeaway was essentially that what happens to us at birth, you know, having a complicated birth, having a C-section, having like a vacuum-assisted birth, these types of things can trigger multiple and common gut microbial pathways that are leading kids to become overweight and allergic sensitive. To me, this was a big deal because I think that when you look at the numbers of how we're trending in terms of C-sections in the country, it's going the wrong way. You know, like the average is something around like 30% of women get a C-section, when in actuality, it's probably closer to like under 10% that actually need one. And we don't have to get into all the factors of why.
Did you know in Brazil, it's something like 95% of women have C-sections?
Yeah. Yeah. And it's because of, they just wanted to have it scheduled and have it be.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They throw parties, like the whole family comes, like that just blew my mind.
I completely agree. But, you know, we're really starting. I mean, we've known now for a while that the microbiomes of kids that are born vaginally versus C-section are wildly different. And, you know, the next study actually talks about that too, and why that might be. But I think it's just important to pause and say like, okay, wait a minute, we're doing this very common procedure, but maybe actually it's going to have some long-lasting impacts that we don't even know about yet. Like, we're starting to identify, you know, obesity and allergies and all these types of things. But like, what else is important that microbiome is in place from the very beginning?
Yeah, listen, it's very much a butterfly effect, right? Like, we don't understand something that we're doing at this point. Could it have vast ramifications? And again, I always, you know, I'm a big fan of sometimes taking a step back and realizing that as sophisticated as we are, like scientifically, you know, all these things, 100 years ago, we would, you know, if someone was hurt in war, that, you know, they would basically get them drunk and cut their leg off and hope for the best. Do you know what I mean? Like, we're like a person and a half removed from that being the state of medicine. They didn't even realize germs were an issue till, you know, whatever it was, probably 120 years ago, right? So it's very much still an art as much of it as it is a science. So to your point, like, some of these things that now we're taking as, and I think what you're kind of getting at is, these are increasingly being done for cosmetic or convenience reasons. And there are real ramifications to that, you know? So I think, again, it's just going to get more acute as we start to further appreciate, you know, the role of that process in setting you up for, you know, health throughout your life, right? So it's very fascinating. And then the other thing that's kind of interesting is, and I don't know if this is more just me being curious. Do you know if there's any socioeconomic sort of bent to who is typically getting a C-section? Do you have any clue about that?
I'm not sure. Actually, it could go either way, right? It could be that wealthier women are scheduling them because they want the control. Right. And it could also be the other side where, you know, you have
a doctor almost wants the control.
Exactly. Yeah. So I'm not sure. We'd have to dig into that.
Yeah. So that's where it would be interesting to me to understand. My mind where it instantly went to is this could be very much an issue of correlation versus causation. And are there other issues like the diet of the child? You know what I mean? Like, is that playing a role versus it just being about the microbiota? That's where this gets really interesting, right? Like, is it sort of, you know, false positive as you know, a causation? But mm-hmm. I don't know. There's definitely obviously data. I don't know if we've talked about this, but there was, you know, there's been cases of fecal transplant where I think it was a mother and a daughter. One of them had C. diff, and the healthy one who was obese donated, you know, fecal matter for the transplant, and the other one became better, got rid of C. diff, but then they became obese, you know? So it seemed to indicate there was some sort of correlation there. So we definitely know that microbiota has a role with obesity, but it's interesting at that age, you know, to see what that role would be.
Yeah, absolutely. There's so many factors involved. I just pulled up socioeconomic stuff for C-sections, and there's very conflicting things. On one study, it said that, low socioeconomic women are more likely to have C-sections. But then at another one, it said participants with middle wealth were 44% more likely to have C-section compared to those in the poorest group. So I guess it depends how you're slicing the pie. You know, it's not definitive.
That's interesting.
Well, okay, going back to that piece on fecal transplants. So that was the other piece of this. And, you know, when people have C-sections now, there's a lot of talk of vaginal seeding, which essentially is just taking a swab from the mother, from her vagina, and then wiping it all over the baby. I mean, it's a little bit, you know, more, it's a little bit more than that, but essentially that's what you're doing. And it's not always very successful. So there was a study that came out where they were basically feeding a tiny bit of fecal matter from the mother to the babies that were born by C-section. And they found that instead of taking, typically it takes a full year for the transition to happen where you start to see similarities between babies who were born by C-section and babies who were born vaginally. And with this, their microbiomes resembled vaginally born babies within 3 weeks. So obviously a big ick factor, right? Like feeding your newborn baby your poop. And obviously this should never be done at home.
This was certainly done in
the context of a study.
So did they talk about whether they, because when you do, typically when they're doing fecal transplant, like that fecal matter is so rigorously like processed and like encapsulated, like there's all sorts of things to make sure it's, you know,
Yeah, no, for this one, it wasn't. So they did test to make sure that the women had pathogen-free samples. So they were giving their own fecal matter to the babies. And it was a fairly small study. I mean, it was 17 mothers who were preparing to give birth via C-section. They had their fecal samples scanned. And then after birth, the researchers mixed, it looks like 3.5 or 7 milligrams of diluted fecal matter into 5 milliliters of breast milk. And then that was fed to the babies. Wow. So it's pretty, it was pretty just like, let's make sure there's nothing in here, but we're not going to, you know, clean it up. And the researchers in the study also said there's a reason that, here, I'll read the exact quote actually.
Where was this done?
A journalist in Paris reported on it. This was in Science Mag. So I don't see exactly what country.
So was it done in Europe? You don't know.
I don't know. I have to dig into it a little bit more.
My initial thing is like every clinical trial that's done in the US, you have to get what's called IRB approval, like Institutional Review Board approval, which is basically like, you know, a committee making sure that the safety of people in the study is not going to be compromised, right? So I am shocked with a baby, especially a baby that's just born, that they'd be able to get IRB approval for something like that. But so that makes me think it wasn't done in the US.
It does seem all of the people that are quoted in this are in Europe. So it does seem like it was not here.
So my view on this is, and obviously, you know, I believe in the power of the microbiome. I also believe babies at that point are so immunocompromised that if something's off, you're going to have a big issue, right? Like if there's candida in that fecal matter, if there's, I don't know, pathogens at super low levels, it could still cause issues with the baby. So my initial thought is that it's pretty wild. like obviously it sounds super promising, but like, that's one of those things like, wow.
I mean, I think too, you bring up a good point. If these babies truly were being born via C-section because there was a problem, although it does say that these women were scheduled for C-section. So I don't know that, you know, there was anything wrong with the baby. So, and they did say the infants didn't experience any adverse effects during the study period. But again, wow. You know, they mentioned that they don't know how much babies ingest naturally coming through the birth canal. So getting the right dose requires careful testing, and they don't have that answer yet.
That's wild.
Very. Yeah. Yeah. The one quote I want to read it real quick just because I mentioned it earlier. I don't want to leave people hanging. It says, there's a reason the orifice for having babies is next to the anal orifice in all vertebrates. This is natural selection, not random. And it's a clear message from nature telling us we want the newborn to be exposed to feces. So.
Yeah. My response to that is kind of like, sure. That's one of those things like on the back end, no pun intended. Like you can say like, maybe, but like, it's not a given that a child's going to ingest, you know, fecal matter. I understand, you know, the relation to the two, but it's really, really fascinating actually.
Yeah. It's correlation versus causation for sure, which is something we talk about. And then the last piece on this was after the baby's born, you know, we talk about breast milk and how important that is for seeding the microbiome. And there was a new study that shed some light on why breastfed babies have different microbiomes than formula fed. But really, the story here is less about that and more about this technique that was developed. So the technique allows researchers to go in and track specific nutrients as they're taken up by the gut microbes. They used a mouse's digestive tract to do this. And they could actually see which bacteria were eating different things and producing different metabolites. So it's really the first study that reveals how specific metabolites promote specific growth of bacteria in the GI tract, which opens the door to, you know, be able to start telling patients if we could see how certain foods are interacting with their microbes and creating different metabolites, which is really just the byproduct of everything that's in your gut, like what it's producing, which can be...
Well, that's what I was going to say. Like maybe it's worth taking a step back to explain like what metabolites are, because I know that's something that is just now getting into sort of the conversation.
Yeah. Do you want to take that?
Well, you're usually better at like making it not sound, you know, sure. ornery, but
yeah. I mean, we have a whole episode on this too with Aubrey Levitt. It was pretty early on, I think maybe episode 14 or 15. So she does a great job of explaining it. But essentially, a metabolite is something that is produced as a byproduct of metabolism. So when you ingest something, your bacteria and fungi and everything that's in the gut are consuming it. And then what they, for lack of a better term, excrete and, you know, get come out the other end, those are called metabolites. And those can have wide-reaching impacts, we're starting to learn, almost more so than the actual bacteria themselves for health. So these are things like short-chain fatty acids, something that you may have heard of. So this study specifically was looking at how those metabolites were produced and the interaction of how that created more bacterial growth in the GI tract.
Yeah. And I think you said the critical thing is we could be sitting here, you know, 10 years from now, realizing that it's the metabolites that are responsible for the health and wellness implications more so than the organisms itself. You know what I mean? It's almost like the corn versus the husk, right? In fact, one of my father's current NIH grant is specifically studying the mechanism of action of metabolites in the microbiome, you know, fungal community in the body. So yeah, I think that is where we're going to end up having the conversation way more about metabolites over the coming years.
Yeah, I actually just met someone else who is a researcher at Case, and he's in the immunology department, and he is studying blood cancers. And he said the metabolites are a huge factor in his research as well. So it's definitely an area to watch. And I think to bring it back down just to like an everyday person, you know, if we could have this type of technique available, maybe this is the next stage of the testing that we were talking about before, right? You see something's off, maybe we go to something like this technique, and then we can actually tell patients, okay, eat these foods because they will promote certain metabolites. That will be what changes the composition of your microbiome, rather than just add these blanket probiotics or blanket approach for what foods we think might be helpful.
Very cool.
So this last topic here is something that really made me laugh. I actually texted it to you when I saw it. So I'll read the headline and I want your reaction, and then we can kind of break down what it actually is about. So it's healthy gut microbes key for space travelers to reach Mars.
My initial thought is I don't even know what that means, other than I'm like trying to take it like, is it going to allow them to hibernate? Is there something like, so fill me in.
Yeah, I mean, it's really less interesting than it sounds. It just made me laugh because I feel like we're so far away. And it just goes to show you like the microbiome is so hot now that it is literally anything. Being tied to anything and everything that we can talk about. So it does just say that space in general can cause nausea. It can change, you know, the gut microbiome of the astronauts that are in space. And this really leads to the breakdown of the complex relationship between our microbes and ourselves. So they were saying that when astronauts go to space, they see an increase in bacteria that's associated with intestinal inflammation and a decrease in the anti-inflammatory ones. Hmm. So really, as people start to do more space travel, giving them meals with lots of fiber, kickstarting their microbial metabolism before they go can be really helpful. And I just love the last line of this. It says, well, future missions to Mars will undoubtedly look for evidence of microbial life on the red planet. This review suggests that it might be our homegrown microbes that will get us there.
Oh my God.
So we'll end on that note. Nothing really to talk about there, but we'll certainly link to it in the show notes. We did change the show notes. We redid the biome site. So they're at biomehealth.com. If you click on the blog and podcast tab, you'll find them. And we will link to those in the description of this episode as well. All right. Afif, thank you so much. It's always a great time.
Yeah, it's always fun. Like what I do love about this area is we will never run out of things to discuss, from feeding babies poo to missions to Mars. Like it's really amazing.
And if anyone out there has a topic that you have seen or want us to riff on, email it to us, or a question. Yes, anything. We are all ears at themicrobiomereport@gmail.com. So Afif, thank you as always. We'll talk soon.
All right. Take care.
Bye. Thanks as always for listening. Don't forget you have access to 10% off at Biome's site on any product with the code BIOME10. And while you're there, check out all the show notes for this episode, including all the links to the studies we mentioned at biomehealth.com/pages/podcast. Until next time, I'm Andrea Wiene.